we go into the word, we were just reminded that God's word doesn't return void. And so let that be our prayer as we open His word. Father, we thank you, Lord, that your word is true. And we ask, Lord, that you would speak to us and that you would send it out to achieve all that you have sent it to do. In Jesus' name. Some of us were meeting on Tuesday where we heard Vishal Mangalwadi speak. And he was speaking of how could God still work today? And one of the comments that he made, which stuck in my mind, was he said that one of the reasons the church is having so little impact on the world of society today is that we have imbibed the wrong eschatology. Before I lose you on that, let me ask you then, if that's true, what is your and my eschatology? What is eschatology? Perhaps you're asking me because you didn't know you had it, but we all have it, right? What is eschatology? Eschatology, according to the Oxford Dictionary, is it's that part of theology that's concerned with the death, judgment, and final destiny of the soul and humankind. It's the combination of the Greek word eschatos, which means last, and logi, of course, which is study. So it's literally the study of the last, study of the end times. And why is it that what we believe about what will happen in the end is so important to us? Because it affects everything that we do and believe. C.S. Lewis said, if you read history, you will find that the Christians that did the most for the present world were precisely those who thought most of the next. It's since Christians have largely ceased to think of the other world that they have become so ineffective in this. And that's rather counterintuitive. We think that when I remember growing up, we're so heavenly minded that we have no earthly use. I think scripture would put it another way, that we do need to have an understanding of what is our destiny, where is the end, because that has cast a shadow on what we do today. Paul, writing to the Thessalonians, says that he wants to explain to them what will happen because he wants them to have hope. He wants to encourage them. The writer to the Hebrews in chapter 6, he says he wants them to move on from the basic things. And what are those basic things? One of those he includes is the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. He counted that among the basics, along with repentance and faith. And he said you need that so that you are able to stand firm. So I think there are three things that I believe God will have for us this morning. We're going to look at what Paul has to say, what John has to say, and what Peter has to say about that. First, let's look at what Paul has to say to the Thessalonians. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And we read 4 verses from there, 5 verses, verses 13 to 18. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And he says there, now dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died, so you will not grieve like people who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. We tell you this directly from the Lord. We who are still living when the Lord returns will not meet him ahead of those who have died. The Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. First, the believers who have died will rise from their graves. Then, together with them, we who are still alive remain on the earth, will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and then we will be with the Lord forever. So, encourage each other with his word. Paul wants to encourage us this morning with this passage. And one of the most important tasks that you and I have before each other is that we encourage each other. We must encourage each other with the good news that Jesus Christ is coming back. It would seem from the context that these believers had expected the Lord to come back imminently. And now some of their members are passing away, they're dying. And Jesus hasn't come back. And they're worried. Are those who die going to miss out on that party when he comes back? And Paul wants to tell them that there's nothing to worry about. Those who have died will not miss a single thing. Recently, after my dad's funeral, someone asked me, he said, how could you be so composed? And my response was, how could we be sad? Right? We are talking about his homecoming. We're celebrating. He's been released from the body that was aging, that was crumbling, and we know that he's face to face with the Lord. That's something to celebrate. We believe, Paul says in verse 14, that Jesus died and was raised to life again. That's the bottom line. Since, he says, since we believe that Jesus has died and rose again, I think that every one of us here agrees and believes, we also believe, he says, that God will bring him back, will bring back with him the believers who have died. One follows by necessity after the other. If Jesus rose from the dead, then we believe all who have died and have put their faith in him, are hidden in him, will also rise also. And Paul says he must come back and he must get them back if he has risen from the grave. Look at verse 14 closely. I want to read it in the NIV because that's a little clearer. He says, for we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring back with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. The writer Paul uses two different words for that. Some translations I think uses died both, but the word behind it is different. We believe Jesus died, and later he says, bring back with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. Died and asleep, it's not synonyms. He's not using words to make good literature so it doesn't repeat itself in the same sentence. But he's saying that, this is not saying that in one book commentary put it, death is what Jesus experienced, sleep is what you and I experienced. Death, what is death? Death is the God-forsaken experience of a condemned soul. Right? We talk about death, eternal death, separation from God. And that is what Jesus experienced on the cross. That death, he died in the fullest and in the most horrible sense of the word. When we put our faith in Christ, God put us in Christ. His death swallows up our God-forsaken death. And so you and I don't have that death anymore. Our condemnation was taken by him on the cross and paid for it there. When God raised him up from the dead, death's sting was gone for us. And his sin sentence fully paid. So when our bodies die and give out, we don't die, we sleep. Jesus died, we sleep. Alexander McLaren writes, his death makes our death sleep, and his resurrection makes our sleep calmly certain of awakening. But Paul wants them to know, but where are these people who are asleep? Are they just there in the ground? And he says, no. In the next verse, he says, God will bring back with Jesus those who have fallen asleep. And the next chapter, verse 10, he says, chapter 5, he says, he died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Those who have fallen asleep in the Lord, beloved, are together with him, are living with Christ today. D.L. Moody said it, and later when Billy Graham said it, it was described to him as well. He said, one day you will hear that D.L. Moody is dead. Don't you believe it? In that day, I will be more alive than I've ever been before. Dallas Willard said, it will take me a while to realize that time. You will be actually more alive than you have been before. And so it is. How is that for you and me? How is it that they who have passed away are sleeping in Christ, and yet they are with him today? Well, their bodies are sleeping today, but today they are consciously present with the Lord. And we have that assurance for each one of us who has lost someone that we love, but who died with the Lord, we know that they are present with the Lord today. And Jesus told the thief on the cross, he said, today you will be with me in paradise. Paul said, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. They will not miss out on anything. That's what Paul wants the Thessalonians to know. In verse 15, he actually uses one of the strongest negatives in the New Testament. He says, we tell you that we who are still alive and who are left until the coming of the Lord will certainly not receive those who have fallen asleep. There's a certainty about it. And what will happen when the Lord comes? We don't know all the answers, but there is enough here for God to say, and there's enough to encourage us one another with these words. Someday, when the Father says the time has come, the Lord will rise from his throne, pass that altar of sacrifice with his blood, stained with his blood, pass the incense of the fragrance of the saints of the prayers, pass the awesome living creatures, bring an archangel with him, and come across the skies, and step through heaven and earth, and come back for his people. And this time when he comes back, there will be no need for a staff, there will be no need for shepherds, no disguise of a baby, no swaddling clothes in a manger. Everyone would know that it's love. As C.S. Lewis says, when the author walks on the stage, the play is over. This time, there will be no mistaking his coming. He will come, as Paul says, with a loud command. What will he shout? I don't know. The students asked the professor who was talking about the second coming, what will he say? And the professor had to admit, I don't know. But perhaps he will say enough. Enough. Enough of war, enough of pain, enough of suffering. I know. Perhaps he will say comfort. As someone said, if he hadn't specified Lazarus comfort, perhaps everyone would have come to him. We hear that word. But what we do know from scripture is that he will come with the voice of an archangel, and one of the chief princes of heaven who have stood up by us over the centuries guarding his people, has been listening to the prayers of the saints, which we have gone out to allow, O Lord, and has been in conflict with Satan, will accompany him now. It says he will come with the trumpet of the Lord, with a brass trumpet, gold trumpet, the shofar, we don't know. But like the trumpets of Jericho, announce that the world's walls are falling down. And Paul says that the dead in Christ will rise first. Even though today they are with the Lord, they are not complete. They will now experience the resurrection of their physical bodies. And almost as if they were entering a dressing room, they will put on robes, they will put on their new bodies, Christ-like bodies that they have been waiting for. Bodies that are fit to live forever, minds unhindered by the lies of the world, hands that will serve the Lord for eternity, ears attuned to hear heaven's praise, and hearts clean enough and pure to behold the face of God. And after that, we who are alive will be caught up or raptured, as he says, the word is seized or carried off. We're seized from all that ways that drags us down to this world, and we rise to meet the Lord in the air, and meet together with them in the clouds. What a reunion! Does that encourage us? Does that excite us? God's people to date have never been together. Hebrews writes of that great cloud of witnesses, and that cloud grows each day. But we've never all been together as a church. But one day we will all be together, all joined together in the air, which so far has been with the reign of Satan. It will now be forever with the reign of Jesus. And we shall see him. Not on pump, not with sandals, not even stand, not on the cross, not even standing by an empty grave, but we will see him in all his glory. And Paul says, encourage one another with that word. And I pray that that would be a word of encouragement for each one of us. If we are down and we feel that we're getting good, Christ is coming back again. And he's coming back in all his glory, and he will take us to himself. But that's John adds more to that. Not only do we have encouragement, we have hope. And I want you to turn with me to Revelation chapter 21 and look at John's account of the end time. Revelation chapter 21, and I'm reading from verse 1. And then he says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. There was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them, and their God. what we now just read, the new heaven and the new earth, the city of God. And as wonderful as the first resurrection was, it was only the first installment. John didn't write the book of Revelation as a mystery, but he wrote it as a letter towards God and given to a church, the churches there in Asia Minor who were going through persecution and who were going to go through great persecution. They were going to face terrible things. And God tells, and that's the only book it says, it is a blessing of reading it aloud in the church, because he gave it to his people so that they would be helped through what they were going to face. And we too, as we face uncertain days and certain future, we also can have hope when we read God's word. And what is it that John sees? He sees the word coming down. John has a vision of the end of history. And it's not individual souls rising up and escaping this earth. And that's why eschatology is so important. Because sometimes we can have an escapist view, right? But we see that heaven is coming down and transforming the earth. We sing that song, heaven came down and glory filled my soul. One day that's literally going to happen over here. Not just our bodies, but an absolutely perfect, rewoven, material world. We won't hover, we won't be in the clouds, where, you know, floating around. We walk in that city, we dance in the city, we eat in that city. Remember Jesus said, fish with his resurrected body. And our pastors waiting to have sweets in that city. Right, and each one of us has things that we can't do in this body, but we will have perfect bodies to do them. Right? It's not a pie in the sky, beloved. It's real, it's tangible. Peace on earth. All that we long for is coming true one of those days. Verse 3 says that the relationship with God is completely restored. And then he says in verse 4, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, of mourning, of crying, of pain. The old order of things has passed away. You remember Genesis 3, when Adam sinned, that relationship, the perfect relationship was broken. And once the relationship with God was broken, then all the other relationships also started happening. The relationship with nature, the relationship between them as people, relations as families, all those relationships were hurt and lost. And so they had to hide from God, they had to toil against the soil, and they began in their own bodies to experience decay and death. And we see that in our world. Fundamental to all the challenges and relationships around us that are wrong, it's because we don't have the right relationship with God. But one day, that relationship will be fully restored. And that's why we long, we wait for that day, because there's something in each one of us that the world cannot give. But when that relationship is put right, then everything else will be right. Heaven will come down, and glory will fill this earth. But what was the need? Why this promise? John's writing to those people. We read the letters of 1st, 2nd, 3rd Revelation, and we kind of separate it from the rest of the book. But he's writing to these people who are suffering terrible things. This was the time of Emperor Domitian, and historians are dividing on whether he was as bad as Nero of Caligula, he was a little better than Nero of Caligula, or the shades of red. But at the end of the day, there was still certainly persecution. Right? And Christians were being persecuted for their faith. They were being killed for their faith. They were dying in the Colosseum, thrown to the lions. Under Nero and Caligula, they were put, painted with tar and lit as torches to light the city. And they were crucified. So the people all around knew this is what happens. You face, take the name of Jesus Christ. And yet, what happened? Tertullian says the blood of the martyrs is like seed. The church grew and grew. Why? Because they had this hope. They took their suffering with such poise that the more the people killed them, the more the church grew. Because they had this hope for them. That's why the way we live now is absolutely controlled by what we believe about the future. And what is that for each one of us? Today, you and I may not be facing imminent physical persecution by God's grace. But if this world is all that we've got, then there's not much that we have to live. die for. But if we believe that there is a day of reckoning when God will indeed set everything right, if we believe there is a day when God will make all things new, then that gives us the strength to be able to face the challenges that we have. God, John's hope that he gave that enabled him to face much harder things than you and I have to face. You remember the Negro, if you look at Negro spirituals, we see the same dynamic over there. When they suffered through those times of slavery, persecution, of absolutely no hope, read some of those Negro spirituals. They held on to that hope when one day the world would be renewed, when they would see their Savior, when there would be peace and there would be joy. And they sung this faith, as someone has said, the sung faith served to deepen their capacity of the slaves for endurance and their ability to absorb suffering. They fashioned a hope that the environment with all its cruelty could not crush. Same for them, same for the early church, and I believe that's what God's giving to us today. Because they knew and believed in a new heaven and a new earth, it helped them to keep their hope above their situation. What about us today? We face uncertain days, and we're worried about things, but nothing like many of our fellow Christians around the world. Even today, there are believers who are being persecuted. Statistics say that persecution has as much today as it has been, right? We may not throw people to the lions, but there is still slavery. There is still threat. There are still parts of the world where you think it's dangerous to take the name of Jesus. Plus, there are the personal issues that we face. I was visiting a hospital this week, and as I was meeting the doctor, he said, four people before him, I had walked in, he said he was dealing with them, all young people, but we diagnosed their world has collapsed. How do they face the future? Right? How? Through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. In verse 6 he says of that passage, to the thirsty I will give water without cost, and spring from the spring of water life. You remember John who wrote this wrote also John's Gospel. And in chapter 4 of John's Gospel, Jesus met this Samaritan woman by the well, and he had promised to her that he would give her water, right? That if she drank, she would never thirst. And here we see that fulfillment and that promise in the New Jerusalem. All the deepest longings of her soul and our soul will be satisfied in that river. And yet, beloved, we can have a foretaste of that now, today. Why? Because he went to the cross, and on that cross he said, I thirst. Just because our death was swallowed up, his death, our thirst has been taken by his thirst. He experienced the cosmic thirst and hopelessness that you and I deserve to have, so that you and I do indeed the thirst, and we can have a living hope. He didn't just die, but he's raised, and he's making everything new. No matter what has happened, we know that it can only make us better. Donald Gray Barnhouse, the theologian of the last century, lost his wife when she was fairly young, and he had a young daughter, about 10 or 11, and he was struggling how to explain to her, how to explain the reality of what the loss of her mother and his wife was. And one day they were walking through the city, I don't know, New York or Philadelphia, and a bus came opening close and almost knocked him down, but he was able to pull her out of the way. And as he saw that, got the explanation that he was looking for. And he asked his daughter, did the bus hit you? She said, no. What did, well, the shadow hit us, right? And he said, that's exactly what happened to mommy. Death didn't hit mommy, only the shadow of death hit her. And you and I, we only get hit today by the shadow of death, because the real death is Jesus. We have that hope now. Christ, as the hymn writer says, Christ the Lord is risen today. And it goes on to say, made like him we rise, ours the cross, the grave, the skies. That's our hope this morning. Let's be encouraged. Let's have hope. And lastly, I just wanted to share a few verses from 2 Peter chapter 3 and what Peter has, as he also writes to the church at that time. All these writers are writing to a church that's facing huge challenges, huge persecution. And Peter deals with a sense of time, because sometimes we feel, well, it's so long. Does it still have relevance? And so he says in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 4, he says, they will say, who's that to stop us? He says, where is this coming? He promised. Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends, that the Lord today is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. And then he goes on to say, the day of the Lord will come like a thief. In verse 14 he says, so then, dear friends, since you are looking forward to this, make every effort to become spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. Like John and Paul, Peter too is writing to people facing persecution. And with the certainty that Jesus is coming back, he encourages them to stand first. God gives us encouragement and hope so that we can be steadfast, so that we can have resilience, so that we can have endurance. We don't know what lies ahead, but we do, and we don't know when, but we do know what will be there at the end. And so he calls us, like those first century Christians, to stand firm, to hold our ground, to not run away in the face of the challenges. And this is, beloved, where our eschatology hits the door. It's not enough for us to be individually encouraged. The hope needs to be transformed into a purpose for each one of our lives. We pray, give us this day our daily bread. And I've learned over the years, I know I need to trust God every day for that provision. We can't take it for granted. But somehow the prayer that this kingdom comes will be that the kind of things not going to happen today. Right? That's part of the prayer. But it will come one day. I believe that just as we pray for our daily bread, God wants us to pray that this kingdom will come and His will be done today on earth, even as it is in heaven. And we don't need to just push it into the New Jerusalem. It's part of what He calls us to do. In 2 Samuel 23, we have a brief mention about a guy called Shammah. And all it says is that when he was being chased by the Philistines and the army of Israel had run away, he stood his ground in a field of lentils, dal, bread, and the rest of the army fled, and the Lord brought about a breakthrough. Something made him hold his ground, and everybody else ran, he held his ground. And I just went online to see what does a field of lentils look like. You know, basically people eat the lentils, we don't know how they grow, right? But lentils are about 15, 16 feet high. And I just thought 15, 16 inches high, hard to run in a field of bushes. You can't hide, and at the same time, you're not going to be able to run very fast. But all the rest of the army managed to run, he decided to stand his ground. And he took the Philistines on, and God gave a great victory. He single-handedly beat the army, right? Why did he not run like the rest? I don't know. But I guess he realized there's no point running for your life. There's no reason to live. And like Shammah, Peter reminds us, there's a time, and I believe for each one of us, that time keeps coming when it may become more acute in the world that we live in, that you and I have to decide what we stand for. What do we believe? Will our faith be proven genuine, even as Peter says, if it's defined by fire? If we only take the encouragement in the knowledge that we'll be with the Lord forever, but do not live with that confidence, then our eschatology will never change the world. And the prayer of His kingdom come and His will be done will just be words. As Irvin McManus puts it when he talks about Mulder and Scully from X-Files, he says, for them the future was bleak and ominous. All they could do was fight the future rather than fight for the future. To fight for the future, we must have hope. And we have a living hope. We have a part in making His kingdom come. In Irvin McManus' book, The Last Arrow, he says, the church has become an institution that preserves the past and fears the future. The church has become more a reflection of what we're running from and what we're running to. No wonder we have lost the path to change the world. I pray that would not be true for each one of us part of the body as Christ. For many of us, our hope is only to escape from this world. One of the hymns of the second coming, which was, I loved singing when I was in school. It said, "Heart aches all end, its school days all done. Heaven will open, Jesus will come." Somehow at school, and that hymn was not so relevant anymore. But if our eschatology is right, and I believe there's a problem with that, those kind of things, it should be the truth for the future. If God is the God of yesterday, today and tomorrow, then that must fill us with inexpressible hope for today and confidence for tomorrow. A new city is coming, but for now He has placed us in this city. And with God's help, maybe each of us take a stand, encourage one another, and with confidence live and pray. His kingdom will come and His will be done in us and through us here in this city as it is in heaven. Let's pray. Father, as we prayed earlier, Lord, for this world and for us, we ask for the living power to remake us. We thank you for the hope that you have secured as your word tells us its anger exactly. Lord, I pray that you would give us power today, that you would give us courageous hearts, that you would give us hearts and minds that are open, Lord, to all that is done for us. And as that early church stood firm, Lord, we are the beneficiaries of their faithfulness. Lord, I pray that we too will be found faithful. One day, Lord, we look forward to that day when we will see you face to face and be part of you.